thanks for having me. I guess I originally intended to talk more about, I thought that would be more interesting to talk about kind of the similarities and differences I saw between doing the kind of work that we do in from Wall Street to consumer web to biomedicine, but I have sort of an allergy to like vision talks. After I started a company that does like enterprise software, and you have to go and talk about the value of big data and blah, blah, blah a lot. So I really just kind of like talking about what I work on now and the specific outputs that we're creating. And then I'm happy to have a more unstructured discourse on my experiences at the end, where you know we can just kind of walk through and be directed by your interests. And I'm happy to talk about my experiences from doing Harvard math with Danny back in the early 2000s through to working in medicine today. So in September 2013, I started a group at Mount Sinai here in New York. And the thesis behind this group was that I would take people who had skills similar to those of the people that I had hired at Facebook and at my company Cloudera, and I would bring them into biomedicine without really any domain knowledge and see if we could bring the software tools and practices from our domain into this domain. So specifically wanted to have people with no biomedical experience, just kind of curious about running that experiment. So didn't really have a disease focus. In early 2015, we decided to focus in on cancer immunotherapy. So really understanding and improving how your immune system responds to cancer. I tried to keep the group small. So we have two, what I would call operators, people who think about creating the conditions for work, myself and Cindy. And then there are 11 individual contributors who are actually doing the work. And I have to mention that there are two little squares here that are empty, so we're hiring. We'd like to find a machine learning engineer and then someone to help improve our development infrastructure. So if there's anybody in the audience or any friends of people in the audience, I'd really appreciate referrals. I think what we do is pretty fun. So cancer immunotherapy, why did we decide to focus on it? This graph, I think, does the best job of demonstrating why. So these are people who have metastatic melanoma, which is a bad kind of cancer to have, and they were given a new kind of treatment that has no impact on cancer. It's actually targeted at the immune system of the patient. So it's called an anti-CTLA-4 agent, and we'll talk more about what that means. The category of medicine is referred to as checkpoint blockade. So this checkpoint blockade agent was given to these patients, and they were tracked over time. And so this goes out to about 4 years. The results have actually been tracked out past 10 years, and they still hold. So the two important lines are the purple line and the gray line. So the gray line was given the current standard of care, and the purple line was given this new cancer immunotherapy agent. So the authors divided this the results of this clinical trial into three different windows. You can see that in the first 3 months, there was no real difference between the standard of care and this anti-CTLA-4 agent. However, you can see that after 3 months, out to about 2 years, there are some improvements in outcomes. So I'm sorry, I'm so used to staring at these charts, but I should mention that this is actually a very sobering chart in that every time you see a line go down, that's someone dying. So this, we start at the one means that everyone is alive, and zero means everyone's dead. So you can see that people who have metastatic melanoma, they usually die, and they usually die quickly. So the improvement in outcomes being delivered in this sort of two-year window, 3 months to 2 year, are good, but there you can actually deliver those kinds of improvements with a variety of novel cancer drugs. What makes anti-CTLA-4 so exciting and checkpoint blockade as a category so exciting is actually what's happening in this window here. So you can see that most people on the current standard of therapy are dead. What would happen with the standard new cancer drug is that you would see this kind of improvement in outcomes in this two-year window, but then this purple line would collapse down to this gray line after 2 years or so. That's a pretty common, these are called Kaplan-Meier curves. That's a pretty common Kaplan-Meier curve to see. This, however, is extraordinary. So what you see, these people in purple who aren't dying, you can extend this line basically out to like 12 years now, and they're just still alive. So this is what you would call a durable remission in clinical trials lingo, but many people would call this a cure. So this is what really drew me to work on cancer immunotherapy, is there are a lot of ways to deliver improvements in outcomes on the time scale of 1 to 2 years, but there are very, very few drugs that are gonna deliver durable remissions and allow people to survive for 10 or more years. And a lot of that, we believe, is due to the fact that we're treating the immune system and not the cancer. And so the immune system, in the same way that cancer is adaptive, the immune system is adaptive. And hopefully by improving the immune response, you generate not just the short-term remission of the cancer, but actually long-term protection from cancer. So that chart's exciting, but the game is on to figure out why 100% of the people are not responding. So this plateau that we saw, it's very exciting, but it would be a lot more exciting if the plateau was up here. So what can we do to raise the plateau? Well, one thing that was done is a different checkpoint blockade agent was introduced, and this one targeted a different protein. This is an anti-PD-1 agent, and this is called nivolumab. And nivolumab outperformed the anti-CTLA-4 agent, ipilimumab. So the plateau for nivolumab is higher than the plateau for ipilimumab, which is exciting. But even more exciting is that when you combine nivolumab and ipilimumab, the plateau is even higher. Now, the numbers are very thin here, so it's hard to make to draw conclusions, but it does appear that we're creating an improvement. We're raising the plateau. And so really, this is, to me, the most important problem in cancer therapy right now. And because cancer is such a large contributor to the global burden of disease, it's really one of the most important problems in biomedicine right now. And that is, how can we take the response rate from checkpoint blockade from this, call it 40 to 50% right now with the combination, and drive it up to 100%? And how can we take it from indications beyond melanoma to every form of cancer? So to give you a sense of the scale of the people working on this problem, there are currently over 1,000 clinical trials that include some form of checkpoint blockade agent in them that I could find on clinicaltrials.gov. And those trials encompass over 200,000 subjects. 39 trials have already reported on the results of over 14,000 subjects. So these are people who went through the clinical trial. We had enough time to observe their outcomes, and a lot of their data has been made available. So this is almost 15,000 people for whom we can search for predictors of who will respond and who will not respond. And the lessons we learn from these 15,000 people can then be applied to the 200,000 subjects who are planning to enroll in clinical trials soon, and then to every cancer patient. So only 4% of cancer patients enroll in a clinical trial. So even though 200,000 subjects sounds like a lot, this is just a subset of the clinical trials in cancer, and that is a massive subset of the people who have cancer. So this is a big problem, not just in terms of humans, but also in terms of dollars. The current forecast for cancer drug sales worldwide in 2018 is nearly $150 billion. And checkpoint blockade currently is projected to be about $10 to $15 billion. So that makes up nearly 10% of the cancer drug market. And it's likely to grow quite fast beyond 2018, as the number of clinical trials might indicate. So this is a really, really massive problem, not just in terms of its ability to deliver better outcomes for patients, but also just in terms of economic impact. So that's the society part. So let's talk about the data part. So cancer is a really interesting disease to study, as I mentioned, because it's really a place where you can see evolution happening at short time scales. So cancer, it's frequently said, is a disease of the genome. So every cell in your body has DNA. That DNA is used to make RNA, which makes proteins. Proteins determine the behavior of the cell. And so the DNA is a really important template for understanding the behavior of the cell. And if you sample the cells in a tumor and you sequence their DNA, what you'll find is there's actually heterogeneity within the tumor. And that's unusual. It's supposed to be that all the cells in our body have the same DNA. But cancer cells have gone rogue. They've started accumulating mutations to their DNA. And just like if we drew a tree where each circle in the tree could be a human, and you'd imagine as humans reproduced through the generations, individual humans pick up different mutations, and that equips them with different behaviors. Depending on the selective environment, certain humans will outcompete other humans. The same thing happens in the small scale for cancer cells. So the different colors in this diagram are meant to indicate different families of cancer cells that have equipped themselves with mutations that enable certain kinds of behaviors for those cells. And so what we're dealing with when we're trying to treat cancer is not a single homogeneous disease, but rather a process, which is can evolve away from many different treatment strategies. So I mentioned that these mutations sometimes deliver new behaviors, new functions that the cells can perform. And there's a very influential review paper that described the behaviors that cancer cells equip themselves with, or the tumor as a whole equips itself with, as the hallmarks of cancer. And I don't want to go into too much detail on each of these different capabilities that cancer cells equip themselves with through the acquisition of somatic mutations. But one of the important abilities that cancer acquires is the ability to avoid immune destruction. So your body doesn't like cells that are misbehaving, and it has an enforcer squad of these CD8 positive T cells. So the role of a CD8 positive T cell is to circulate through your body, identify misbehavior, and when it encounters misbehavior, to put an end to it, to kill a cell. And it's looking specifically at misbehavior at the scale of cells. So free-floating particles like bacteria or viruses, those aren't things that your T cells are specifically focused on. They're looking for cells that misbehave. And there's a cancer immunosurveillance hypothesis, which says your T cells are helping avoid cancer in your body by identifying when a cell equips itself with some of these bad behaviors and eliminating it before it can fully form a tumor. It's not a proven hypothesis, but it's something that people believe to be happening. However, sometimes this tumor cells equip themselves with the ability to evade destruction by the immune system, and they grow out of control, and then you end up with a visible tumor, which could be ultimately deadly. And so how does a CD8 positive T cell determine that a cell is misbehaving? Well, it does it through a really clever way. So I mentioned that DNA creates RNA, which creates proteins, and proteins are the primary actors inside of your cells. So to determine if a cell is going bad, there are mechanisms within every cell in your body that will take a subset of the proteins that are inside of the cell and pull them out of production. So in this case, a protein is represented by a chicken. So there are these other proteins called proteasomes, and their job is to take a protein that's been pulled out of production and to chop it up into small pieces. In this case, drumsticks. So you've taken a protein out of production, you've chopped it into small pieces. So those small pieces, a very small percentage of them will be brought into this contained environment, and they will bind to a protein called MHC class 1. So MHC class 1, MHC is short for major histocompatibility. complex. And so MHC is the most variable protein across the population in humans. So there are on the order of about 10,000 different MHC proteins across individuals. So it is like the one area of your genome that varies, the one protein coding region of your genome that varies the most across the population. So this is sort of your immune system's fingerprint. So everyone's different MHC class 1 protein will bind to different fragments of the proteins within that cell. And so this is when you get an organ or a tissue transplant, they're looking at your MHC proteins, and they're trying to match you with the MHC proteins of some donor. And so depending on your specific MHC class 1 proteins, a subset of the protein fragments that were taken out of production will be displayed for inspection on the outside of the cell. So every cell in your body is covered with these peptide MHC complexes. So a fragment of a protein is called a peptide. Those are the chicken legs. And so these peptide MHC complexes, you can think of as a sampling of the proteins that are present inside of the cell. And so every cell in your body is presenting these peptide MHC complexes. They're just covered with them because they have to present a variety of peptides. And so this is an indication of what's happening inside the cell. And so these CD8 T cells, they swim around, and each one of them recognizes a specific peptide MHC pair. And if it happens to, and it only, the ones that it will recognize are known to be bad. So if it binds to that thing, it's going to kill it. And so it goes around inspecting, and if it sees the thing that it knows to be bad, it's going to kill that cell. So that is how your immune system eliminates cells that become, that equip themselves with the behaviors to become cancerous. And the way that they know that it's become cancerous is that there's some alteration in the genome of the cancer cell, which changes the protein. So it changes a protein produced inside the cancer cell to be a version of that protein which is not produced inside of your normal cells. So imagine like, you know, that chicken turns into a duck or something. So now we have duck parts coming through the machinery, and this T cell knows like, hey, that leg, that belongs to a duck. That doesn't belong to a chicken. So I'm gonna kill this cell. So every time a cancer cell acquires a mutation, there's a chance that it alters a protein in such a way that the immune system will recognize it and kill it. It depends on, so mutations can accrue in a variety of ways. So it could happen when the cell divides. It could happen if the cell is exposed to a mutagenic force such as UV radiation or smoking. So there are a variety, so I guess the answer is it depends on where you are in the body and what kind of cell you are. If you're a cell that divides a lot, your probability of acquiring mutations is higher than if you're a cell that has kind of reached its final end state and you're just sitting there. So, and then you have an armory of repair mechanisms. So just because a mutation occurs doesn't mean it remains. So there are various ways that your cells are going in and fixing mutations that they see. So it's difficult to answer that. Every cell in your body kind of accumulates mutations at different rates. So how do checkpoint blockade agents work? Well, that CD8 T cell that we met in the last slide, that was the COP, that's this cell. And the cell in which the proteins are being taken out of production and bound to MHC and being presented to T cells for inspection, that's this cell, that's the cancerous cell. And so when a T cell goes to investigate what's happening inside of a cell, it could be cancer, I mentioned that its T cell receptor, which is specific for one kind of peptide, if it sees the peptide that it binds to, that's important, that's a necessary condition for killing a cell. But it's not a sufficient condition. That's generally called signal one. So that's the peptide MHC on the target cell and the T cell receptor on the T cell. But there's also signal two that's required to kill the cell. And so signal two, one potential way signal two is delivered is via this PD-1 receptor. I misspoke there. I got ahead of myself. So signal two is generally delivered through a different protein that's not displayed on this diagram called CD28. And so that that's a way to activate the T cell. But when a T cell becomes activated, it gets both signal one and signal two from a cell. It kills the cell. Well, T cells are very dangerous to your body. So they can't be turned on for a long time. Your body needs to return to homeostasis. It needs to tell the T cell to chill out. And so T cells have a way of allowing your body to tell it to chill out. So when it receives signal one and signal two to kill a misbehaving cell, it exposes an off switch. It exposes a receptor which is not present on a T cell that's just chilling. So only T cells that have started killing things will have this receptor. And this receptor is the one that's in this diagram. I apologize. So PD-1 is the off switch for a T cell. And normally, the kinds of cells that press the off switch are other cells in your immune system that are working on achieving homeostasis. So they're monitoring the immune response, and when they recognize that the immune response needs to chill out, they press the off switch, your T cell shuts down, we're back to normal. But the problem is cancer cells, which have accumulated somatic mutations, sometimes accumulate a somatic mutation which allows them to display the thing that presses the off switch. So in this case, these are the ligand for this receptor, PD-L1 or PD-L2. So if a cancer cell accumulates a mutation which allows it to press the off switch of a T cell, this is now one way that it can evade the immune system. And yeah, sorry. Yeah, so these it can't turn on its program. So the precise mechanism of action of PD-1 is not entirely known, but what people think is happening is that when the cancer cell presses the off switch, this protein, which is bound to the interior of PD-1, is getting released, and it swims over, and it effectively blocks the intracellular signaling that is downstream from this signal one, from the T cell receptor. So when a T cell receptor gets engaged and it wants to start killing something, it has to kind of communicate that fact to the interior of the cell to turn on the programs for cell killing. And this thing basically short circuits that pathway. So when PD-1 gets pressed, it releases a thing which sort of short circuits the pathway between the exterior T cell receptor and the interior program to do cell killing. So it's basically receiving this signal and it's thinking that it wants to kill stuff, but inside of the cell it's just not turning on the kill stuff program. Yeah, so this bind, this interaction is not being disrupted. So yeah, the T cell receptor can still recognize the presented peptide, but it can't turn on the program to kill it. And that's what we think. So there's actually a surprising gap in terms of our understanding of the mechanism of action. So the what a checkpoint blockade agent is a cover for this off switch. So anti-PD-1, it's a molecule that basically sits here and prevents the off switch from being pressed. So now the T cell can continue on with its killing. So that's, you now know how one kind of checkpoint blockade works, but I wanna make sure that you recognize that this is actually very complex, the immune response to cancer. And so what we've really been talking about is what's here in this cancer immunity cycle, the killing of cancer cells. So this diagram is the exact diagram that I showed on the previous slide. But in order to generate an immune response and to get a T cell into the tumor so that it can do cell killing, there's actually a whole sort of cycle in that your immune system needs to follow. So it needs to first sort of get the scent of the cancer, and then it needs to generate an immune response, and then finally that immune response gets into the tumor and tries to kill some cells. So there are other forms of immunotherapy that target all aspects of this cancer immunity cycle. So what do we do? So I mentioned that the most interesting problem right now in cancer is how can you take the response rate from checkpoint blockade from 40% and turn it into 100% and make it work for all indications. And so what we do is we take data from clinical trials. So we take patients who have had tissue samples and blood draws taken from them while they're being treated with checkpoint blockade or with the alternative standard of care. And we take all of the data generated from those samples and we try and we apply the tools of statistics and machine learning and data science to try and find biomarkers, that is, features that can segregate responders from non-responders. And the hope is we want to find features which are reflect in some way the biology, the mechanism of what's happening inside of your body's immune response to cancer so that these biomarkers, we don't just want to predict who's going to respond and who won't respond. That's valuable, but even more valuable is understanding why the people that respond respond and the people that don't respond don't respond, so that we can suggest new kinds of therapies, so agents that we can combine with checkpoint blockade that will bring that response rate higher. And so one project that we've worked on, so this is a chart from a paper, wasn't our paper, but we actually subsequently did an analysis of the data from this paper and published some a reanalysis of it. But I think this is just a clean representation, and given that they did the original analysis, I thought I'd present their chart. So one potential biomarker is just how many somatic mutations has a cancer accrued. So one of the reasons why melanoma is an early target for immunotherapy is that melanomas generally have more mutations than any other kind of cancer. And that's because melanomas, you're exposed to UV radiation all the time. So these things are melanocytes are getting bombarded with mutagenic forces. So it turns out that having more mutations in your tumor, so these are the patients who received anti-CTLA-4 and had more than 100 mutations in their tumor. And then these are the patients that had less than 100 mutations in their tumor. And you can see that the people that had more than 100 mutations generally responded at a higher rate than the people who had less than 100 mutations. So that's a very interesting finding, and that's led to a lot of subsequent analyses and to see if this finding holds up in other clinical trials. So we had another data set that we worked with, so bladder cancer or urothelial cancer and a different checkpoint blockade agent, anti-PD-L1. And so we tried to bring a little more depth to this analysis. So in our cohort, the patients who received durable clinical benefit did not have an obviously different number of mutations than the patients who did not receive durable clinical benefit. So on the left, on the y-axis there, it's just the number of mutations in the tumor. And so that's interesting. So the finding from the melanoma study didn't repeat in this bladder cancer study. However, if we separated the cohort into people who progressed within the first 3 months of therapy versus people who did not progress, what we found then is we could replicate the biomarker. So our hypothesis there was that there are certain patients for whom the cancer biology overwhelms the immune response, so faster than the immune response can turn on. So if you think back to the first chart I showed you, where the difference between outcomes for patients in the first 3 months was effectively zero if you got the standard of care, if you got immunotherapy. And that's because your immune system takes a long time to turn on. The time scale of your immune system is quite surprising. It can take weeks to generate the full cellular directed immune response. So frequently the first couple months, the patient's tumor will progress because the immune response, it's been turned on, but it can't quite get to the level where it can start clearing the tumor. And so by separating and using some statistical methodology, which allowed us to look at the time varying nature of biomarkers, we were able to better elucidate this phenomenon and restore the biomarker. So this is an example of the kind of analyses we do. I didn't want to get too deep into the science. So the time varying nature of biomarkers is something that we believe we've kind of added to the literature. Another thing that we believe we've added to the literature is a more sophisticated exploration of the interaction of biomarkers. So everyone is proposing new features that might predict response to checkpoint blockade, but no one's really putting them all into a single model and letting them fight it out. So this is something that in quantitative social science is very, very common. You want to separate confounders from something which is actually causally driving change in outcome. We've tried to import some tools and techniques from that world, and to be frank, other areas of biomedicine. It turns out that cancer is not the most sophisticated subset of medicine for biomarker discovery. So if you go look at clinical trials in heart disease, the tools and techniques used there for detecting predictors of response are a little more sophisticated than in cancer. I don't claim that we are sort of light years ahead of the field. Usually when I'm doing work, I'm importing something that I know works somewhere else into a field where just no one's using it yet. And so that's one of the things that we were doing here. And so this is a chart that's going to be pretty difficult to read. But the high level, we're just looking for interactions between biomarkers. And in this case, we're looking at interaction of the red, blue, and green correspond to the levels of things that press the off switch. So PD-L1 in this case. That's the protein. Yeah, what's up? What's HR? That's a hazard ratio. So You can think of as your hazard ratio goes up, as it's greater than one, then as that feature goes up, your likelihood of dying goes up. And if the hazard ratio is less than one, then as that feature goes up, your likelihood of dying goes down. So it'll be easier to understand in this chart here. So hazard ratio here for the specific outcome of mortality. So in this case, for the people who make it beyond 3 months, as their mutation burden goes up, their likelihood of dying goes down because the hazard ratio is less than one. So it's a way of assessing the directionality and magnitude of impact of a particular feature on a particular outcome measure of interest. So in this case, hazard ratio being greater than one means that as that feature goes up, you're going to die faster. And so we looked at the interaction of two different features, one of them being the volume of things that can press the off switch in the tumor, where red is low volume, blue is medium volume, and green is high volume. So you would expect that people with high numbers of things that can press the off switch will probably progress faster. So that should probably send your hazard ratio greater than one as you move up. And we looked at its interaction with a variety of other features. And one of the interactions that was really pleasing to me was the interaction with what this is really measuring is the number of mutations in your tumor. So the same thing we saw in the previous slide, except looking at how it interacts with another biomarker. And in this case, you can see this kind of nice sort of dose response curve right here, where the more things that can press the off switch in your tumor that you have, the more protective number of mutation in your tumor can be. And so that's a pretty intuitive finding that to overcome the resistance of having a lot of things that can press the off switch in your tumor, you need a lot of targets for the T cells. So anyway, we're getting into like sort of cutting edge of cancer immunotherapy biomarker findings, so I don't want to try and dwell on that stuff too much. Yeah, so we can look at where the mutations occur in the tumor. We can also look at the germline mutations present in the patient. So these cohorts are generally a few dozen in people in size. So doing a standard like population genetics analysis where you look at the impact of germline on some outcome isn't really possible at this scale. So we can't really detect much in terms of impact of germline mutations. But in terms of tumor mutations, one common way of increasing your ability to detect its impact on outcome is to group mutations into pathways. So you don't just count them by genes, you count them into sort of like things like functional behaviors of genes, which span many genes. And so yeah, that's a pretty standard form of analysis that we do, is looking at how enrichment of mutations within certain pathways might predict response. So, you know, kind of the point for y'all is that the way we do this work is with like open science and reproducibility in mind. So we made an open source library called Cohorts, which is really a tool built on top of Pandas and other like Seaborn and other visual tools from the PyData ecosystem, which allows us to have a common container for our biomarker analyses. So we've done this now on like 10 cohorts, 10 different clinical trials, and we wanted to have sort of a common language for performing those analyses, and that's what Cohorts provides us. And when we do our analyses, we take every Jupyter notebook that sort of describes the analysis for us. So every time we propose a new analysis, we kind of isolate that into a Jupyter notebook, and then we have all the code for that analysis, and we put that into a publicly available GitHub repository. So you can go and re-perform the analyses. So that's another big issue in this space, is that people are proposing biomarkers, but no one can reproduce the analyses that someone did in a paper, because maybe the data's not available, maybe the code's not available, or maybe it is, both are available, and it's just very unclear and difficult to get running, which is commonly the case, because the way it's presented is just like a tarball, you know, just a folder full of R scripts or something. So that's one thing that we've done to try and improve the reproducibility, but we've also tried to improve the statistical modeling that's being performed, and the complexity of the models, as well as just the ease of interpreting them. So we've been using this tool called STAN, which is an implementation of Bayesian inference using Hamiltonian Monte Carlo, along with a domain-specific language for specifying your models. So there are libraries for doing survival modeling in Python, like lifelines, but they're not built on as sort of powerful of a foundation as Stan. So we've put all of our different survival models that we've constructed and put them into this library called Survival Stan. And then there's an open data set called the Genomic Data Commons, which collects a bunch of data about cancer patients that's publicly available. And so frequently when you're looking at your cohort, you want to look at them within the context of other people who've had cancer and been analyzed. And so this Python library that interfaces with the Genomic Data Commons makes it easy to do a clinical trial data analysis that puts your cohort into the context of the data available up there. And these are just kind of examples of, these are all sort of like one-liners within cohorts. So cohorts, in addition to just structuring analyses, it also, we've tried to make common actions easier to perform. So we kind of generate the same sorts of charts for each analysis. And so these are just sort of chart templates that are present in cohorts. And so we can kind of rip through one of these analyses now pretty quickly. So that's sort of one part of what we do. We're looking for ways to lift the response of checkpoint blockade through analyzing clinical trials data sets and identifying predictors of response that might be indicative of mechanisms that we can target for future combination therapies. So one future combination therapy that's actually in clinical trials right now are these personalized therapeutic vaccines which target neoantigens in cancer. So the idea here is you take a tissue sample from the tumor and then a tissue sample from matched normal tissue or a blood draw, and you do DNA and RNA sequencing on both. And then you look for the mutations that are present in the cancer cells that are not present in the normal tissue, and you look for the impact on proteins in the cancer cells. And then you try and predict, okay, so this protein is different in a cancer cell than it is in a normal tissue. Are there any peptides within that protein which are different in cancer versus normal cells, which we think could cause an immune response for this patient's particular immune system? And then if we can find those peptides that we believe to be found on cancer cells, not found on normal cells, that are going to generate an immune response, we just synthesize that peptide, and we mix it in together with some stuff that just draws the attention of the immune system, and we inject it into the patient. You can think of this as like giving the immune system of the patient the scent of the patient's cancer. And the idea being that you develop a T-cell army at a lymph node nearby to the injection, and then that T-cell army goes from the lymph node to the site of the tumor and does work to eradicate the tumor. So this is one potential way of lifting, and we believe it will combine well with checkpoint blockade. So the idea is that we can use this in conjunction with checkpoint blockade to lift the response rate of patients. And so we aren't the only people who've been doing this. So our collaborator, Nina Bardwaj at Mount Sinai, is really the one who had this therapeutic approach. We're simply the computational people powering it. So I don't want to claim that in some way we sort of derived this idea. And you know, we weren't first. So there were clinical trials underway at Dana-Farber in Boston and at Washington University in St. Louis when we started working, and actually one in a company in Germany called BioNTech. But you know, we were among the handful of early labs who were working on this back in 2013. And this is the results from the first trial to report the results, reported the results from vaccinating three melanoma patients at Washington University in St. Louis. And this is a complicated chart, but basically they saw responses in the immune system to some of the peptides they injected the patients with. So we have an open clinical trial. Internally, we call it PGV-001. Externally, it's called NCT-0272-1043. This is a really nice resource called Open Trials, which gathers information about clinical trials and makes it easy to search against. So you can see that there are 20, oh wow, it's like the 1 year anniversary of the registration of our clinical trial. That's kind of funny. So our goal is to enroll 20 participants. You can't see it on here, but we're looking at a variety of solid tumors. I think there's 6 or 7 different tumor types that make you eligible for this trial. But the patients that we're treating have no detectable disease. So these are patients who've had their tumor removed, And our goal is really to just generate an immune response directed against these peptides that we believe to have been in their cancer, not in their normal tissue. And so if we can prove safety and we can prove and we can get some information that shows us that our vaccine is lifting the immune response against the targets that we want it to be targeted against, then hopefully we can proceed into a phase two trial where we start combining it with checkpoint blockade and we can expand it to other agents. So Nina, our clinical collaborator, has three different clinical trials that she's submitted that we're looking at combining our vaccine with other agents and targeting specific kinds of cancers. So this has been really exciting for us. And this is, to me, it's a quite a unique opportunity. So when you do computational immuno-oncology, you generally are doing it in the discovery setting. So all the stuff that I was talking about in terms of finding biomarkers, you know, what we're trying to do is create information, create new knowledge about how cancer and immunotherapy works to improve the immune response. But in this case, we're actually in the therapeutic loop. So we're, when we get data about a patient in this clinical trial, it is our lab's job to turn that data into a parts list for their vaccine. And so what we say to give to the patient is what gets given to the patient. And the other unique thing about this clinical trial is that the, well, I should say, you know, the clinician can always has final decision, but in terms of, so what we recommend gets given to the patient frequently gets given to the patient. The other unique thing is that every vaccine is different. So what we submitted to the FDA wasn't, hey, here's a chemical that we want to put into somebody's body. We said, here's an algorithm that generates a list of peptides that we want to then print and put into somebody's body. We don't know which peptides it's going to be for each individual. It depends on their cancer and it depends on their immune system. So it's a really a novel therapeutic approach. And you know, when people talk about precision cancer medicine or personalized cancer medicine, I kind of refer to that. Generally what they mean is categorized cancer medicine. So what they mean is they divide people into tumors that have that mutation and tumors that don't. And if you have the mutation, you get this drug. But in our case, we're actually, every single cancer and immune system is unique. We've done analyses of very large cohorts of patients, and we've looked for overlaps in terms of the peptides that we would predict for those patients, and there's very, very little overlap. So this is a really interesting therapeutic approach. It's not actually on this diagram, but so the question was, how do we know we're not killing the person by giving them this drug? Well, that's the point of a phase one clinical trial, is to prove safety. So hopefully we're not. But synthetic long peptide vaccines like ours have been used in other diseases. So we know that the therapeutic modality is generally safe. But in terms of the specific peptides that we send into the person, we can computationally look for peptides which overlap with peptides we believe to occur within the self-proteome, that is, proteins that are present in normal tissue. So the goal of our analysis is to isolate peptides that we believe to only be present in cancer cells. So the T cell army that we create with our vaccine should not be specific for normal tissue. So it shouldn't be killing. I mean, that's something we need to validate, and that is probably the biggest safety risk, is that it wouldn't be. But yeah, I mean, this is a very safe. Vaccines are, you know, how do you know you're not killing a person when you're giving them like mustard gas, which is like, you know, literally what some chemotherapy agents are derived from? Like, that's a much bigger question, I think, for the people who do like chemotherapy to answer than it is for the people that do like vaccines to answer. So this is just an example of the computational pipeline that we run every time we get data from a new patient. So our pipeline we call Epidisco. It's a pipeline for tumor neoepitope discovery. It's open source under an Apache 2.0 license, which means it's free for both academic and commercial use. All of our development happens in the open on GitHub. We made this like nice little web interface for it. It can run on a variety of backends. So pick your favorite grid scheduler and we can generally run with it. So this is a nice little, you can go to Epidisco right now, EPIDIS.co, and this is running. And so if you want to try and create a vaccine, you can. And then behind the scenes, what's happening is this is our internal workflow management tools representation of our cancer vaccine pipeline. So that's what the FDA approved, basically. And so you can see it's pretty complicated. Like there's a lot of software tools that we run. So we've written a lot of open source software for this as well. Our software in this space, so I pointed out, our work on biomarker discovery brings in STAN, which is a library which doesn't have heavy use in biomedicine, but it's something that we knew of from our world in sort of data science and the consumer web. And so we've tried to bring in other libraries like that. So we have a machine learning problem embedded in this pipeline that we solve with some deep neural network techniques. So we can bring in tools like Keras and TensorFlow into this space. We also can use to enumerate the mutations present in cancer cells that are not present in normal tissue. We've written some software that runs on top of Apache Spark, which is a library for distributed computing over data. And then we're writing some software to compute sort of which MHC proteins this particular patient has. And we're using a programming language called OCaml for that. So we believe that these statically typed functional programming languages, of which OCaml is one, are a better way to write reproducible software. And so we're sort of putting our money where our mouth is with Prolotype and that software. So that's really what I wanted to talk about in terms of what our lab does. So every medical talk has to end with a thank you slide. It's like part of the protocol, I guess. So you know, from my perspective, we couldn't do any of the work that we do without the patients who have cancer and are trying these new therapies, which is a very courageous act. But more importantly, they're also committing to allow biopsies to be done and blood samples to be drawn that aren't going to make them healthier, but may make other people healthier. So by contributing their biomaterial to the scientific discovery process, particularly if they do it in a way that allows it to be shared widely, you know, these are the people who are really the tip of the spear in allowing us as you know, humanity to eradicate disease. And so that's, you know, without them, we couldn't do what we do. So the Icahn School of Medicine at Mount Sinai, Dean Charney has been very understanding in letting someone without a PhD and with no biomedical experience run loose inside of Mount Sinai and hire a bunch of people like me. Eric, who runs our department, was really instrumental in that. So Nina is our clinical collaborator and her whole personalized genomic vaccine team. You know, our predictions would be useless if we didn't have Nina to actually synthesize the vaccine and give it to patients. We work closely with Memorial Sloan Kettering, particularly Alex Snyder and Matt Hellman. So they're the ones who really funnel the clinical trial data to us for biomarker discovery. We receive a lot of our funding from Sean Parker's Parker Institute for Cancer Immunotherapy. Nikesh runs their bioinformatics group there, and they provide the infrastructure on which our pipeline runs. And then we work closely with a biotech, which is commercializing this new antigen vaccine. So Joel Grushak runs their clinical informatics group there, and so we work with them on actually hopefully taking these things from phase one clinical trials through to something which gets contributed deployed widely. And of course, all of our work is open source, and we do have a small community of contributors, so they've helped us improve this code and make vaccines better. So that's what we do at Mount Sinai, and I'm happy to open it up to just talk more about how I ended up there and experiences in earlier in my career as well.
Thank you so much, Jeff. So we have some time for questions. And when you ask, before you ask a question, if you can just state your name and your affiliation, that would be great. And pass the mic.
Hi, I'm Ian White, not affiliated. I have two questions, which I'll ask and answer both. First, you mentioned on the outset that you wanted to bring in, as an experiment, data science, machine learning, pros without domain experience. So what are your thoughts on that a year and a half or 2.5 years later? Mm-hmm. And two, I knew of you when you were at Facebook and Cloudera. And this is like completely orthogonal. And so what was the path to ending up here?
Yeah, so to question one, sort of what's the early readout from our experiment? I think pretty good. We've kind of learned what books and what review papers are useful for onboarding. And in fact, we're trying to sort of like write up a blog post on some of the lessons learned in terms of what people should read. In general, biology is such a diverse field that even people who have been working in biology for 30 years might not understand what I just presented. It's so broad. So I think one of the things that's helpful about coming into this domain versus coming into other domains is that the knowledge is so diffuse that you can, if and a lot of it is just being created in the last few years. Like, since new measurement devices are coming online, like, certain things we just didn't know. And in fact, like, early, I talked to a lot of people who've been doing biology for a while. So I talked to George Church, who's a guy up at, in Boston, who's really kind of one of the leaders in genomics, about this, about, like, you know, what knowledge should I try and acquire? And he was like, honestly, like, we sort of rewrite what we know about biology so regularly that trying to understand what people think they know now is not a great way to spend your time. So you basically just, like, find a problem that you find interesting and build your knowledge around that problem rather than trying to just shoot after. That being said, we you know, there's basic, like, cellular and molecular biology. There's the basics of how cancer works, how the immune system works. There are certain sort of, like, foundational texts that we make sure everybody reads that comes through the group. But honestly, people have been able to come up pretty quickly. I'd say the biggest danger is that people just retreat towards their skill set and things they know, and they don't engage with the biology enough. So if I see that happening, then I'll talk to the person and say, like, okay, like, let's make sure. You know, we have an internal discourse instance that we use for paper discussions and other things. Try and get out to conferences a lot. You know, I just try and make sure that people, so the biggest danger, I think, is not that it's hard to learn, but just that people don't make time to learn. So that's kind of one thing I learned. That being said, we've had one or two people that are very good programmers who came in and just never really got the bug. And so, you know, those people just go back to, you know, like, one's at DeepMind now, one's at Sidewalk Labs. Like, so, you know, they just return back to their programmer machine learning roots. And then the second question was, like, you know, Facebook and Cloudera are pretty orthogonal to working in biomedicine. And I actually, somebody asked me this on Quora, and so I wrote up kind of the long answer to this, and I'd be happy to send that to you if you're curious. I guess the short answer is that I've always been interested, you know, John Tukey said the best thing about being a statistician is you get to play in everybody's backyard. And that's, I've always been interested in data because it was just a lens through which to view pretty much every problem in science. And so I always knew that biomedicine was an application domain for data science and one that I wanted to get to at some point. And so I really saw, like, the work that I did at Facebook as just being one instantiation of, like, doing data science, and it just happened to be quantitative social science. And then the work at Cloudera was really just enabling many industries. So, you know, the customers there spanned all industries. So I got a chance to play in everyone's backyard, literally. And then I wanted to return to actually doing data science, not just building infrastructure for enabling data science. And so when I had to choose a domain, biomedicine seemed to combine a lot of things in terms of, you know, it's meaningful, but it's also, the learning curve is very steep, and you can keep learning kind of forever. And I feel like I can stay more motivated in biomedicine than I could in the consumer web or in finance, where I just kind of stop being interested in the problems.
So I'll follow up on that, because I think there's something very interesting as you go through this domain and the work that you've been doing, which is that you've also learned a lot of lessons about how science can be produced within this domain with the technical skills you've learned. And so I'm curious, what would you now tell other domains about the lessons that they should learn in integrating data science, machine learning, you know, statistical mechanisms, and how to think about things based on what you've learned in this domain?
Yeah, so you're saying, like, what are some lessons for places that haven't been, like, fully taken over by the quants? For, like, the best way to let the quants
or not necessarily to let the quants in, but to make certain that the quants do things right. Because one of the things that I see is that, you know, you have had a level of humility of having to understand and having to work with a lot of scientists and appreciate their skills and their expertise. And you've also seen the limitations because of the kinds of practices that you're doing to the work and how it can actually be successful. So I'm curious, like, I mean, those are two things that I see within your talk already, but what are some of the other pieces or the lessons learned as, you know, quant activity starts to affect all of these other domains?
Yeah, so one lesson is, like, don't leave these people alone. Like, my lab has 11 individual contributors. What I see happening in a lot of other labs is, like, it's all biologists and then, like, one or two, like, quanty people. And that's not a way to, like, create a good and healthy environment. I think another lesson is, like, don't treat quanty people as, like, service providers, where you do the structuring of the work and then you hand it to them to do the execution of the task. That's, like, a sort of a anti-practice that I've seen. On the side of the quants who come into the domain, let me go back to the other one. So The most common thing that I see all the time is some leader who has of an institution that isn't very quantitatively excellent, who is just utterly convinced that they are incapable of building this internally, and that they have to outsource it to like IBM Watson or Google or something, as if there's this like magic, you know, they treat it as this like magical capability that only exists within the castles of Silicon Valley, and that like they are hopeless and they have to prostrate themselves in front of this excellence. And that's probably the number one anti-pattern that I see. And it's just so frustrating because, you know, from the perspective of Silicon Valley, these use cases are just marketing. You know, like, so, like, I know a guy who's going to join Google Research to do genomics who was a professor, and I'm like, congratulations on joining the marketing team for Google Cloud. You know, like, that's all it is when you're at Google and you're doing life sciences work, you're in the marketing team for Google. You're not in the, you're not actually creating value for what Google is as a company. And the same thing for IBM, and same thing for even Microsoft. You know, they have this commercial out right now, which is actually a very cool science project where people are going and they're sequencing blood out of just random mosquitoes in Africa to just see like the background thing. But you know, like Microsoft just using that for marketing. It has nothing to do with selling like business productivity software. So if you're not, if your partner doesn't have as their core mission the thing that you have as your core mission, it's unlikely that you're going to be well aligned. And so making a significant outsourcing of the expertise to that organization seems like a bad strategy. So I think like my message to a lot of people is that you'd be surprised at your ability to do this internally if you just sort of like make an effort at it. That being said, I also see people who try and build it internally, but they sort of end up hiring someone who's got the same sort of like charlatan instincts as the like vendor to whom they might have outsourced it. So building it internally can go wrong, can certainly go wrong as well. I guess like don't believe that there is magic also. Like recognize that 80% of your effort's gonna go into collecting and preparing data to be analyzed, and that actually delivering value from the data that you collect and analyze is just because you've created new knowledge doesn't mean you've created value for your organization. Like there's a whole process of linking the knowledge created to the business processes of that organization. Gosh, I don't know. I've you know, you get me started on this topic and I could talk about it for decades. But yeah, don't believe it's magic, I guess, is the one summary. Jeez, I don't know.
Other questions? State your name and affiliation.
I'm Tobias Meitzner from the New School for Social Research. I was positively surprised by the repeated reminders that some of the knowledge you presented, you repeatedly said, we're not sure about that, that might be wrong, there's other views about that, which you don't always have in science and data science talks. So I was wondering, what does that recognition of working with like predictions, unsure knowledge models that could be wrong, what kind of role does that play in your daily work?
Yeah, you know, I found that the people who think that data is, the people who ascribe the most power to statistics and data are not people who do statistics and data science, they are executives who you know, give the like vision talks about the power of data. So I spent a lot of time in industry just kind of talking people down from what they could conclude based on the results of this analysis and what they claim to have known. Like, you know, I've seen just so many like cringe-inducing assertions from like Facebook executives about like why Facebook grew or like how things work. And in my head, I'm just like listening to all these things, and I'm like, I remember that conversation, and like the data on which that is based is just like so utterly flawed and unlikely to be true. But you know, it supports like the mythos of this particular executive. So like, let's just repeat it until it is true. And I don't know like how to teach other people that like skepticism has value, and that like objectivity is very difficult to obtain, and that no matter you know, what you think you've learned, until you've intervened in a system and created change that you predicted based on your knowledge, you haven't really created, you know, like to the point that I was making earlier in terms of like you've created knowledge, but you need to then translate it into a change in the system under study, and that in itself is sort of magic. Yeah, I guess lessons for convincing people that we know less than we do. I don't know if I've ever seen someone move from being like not skeptical to being skeptical. I don't know. God, like one thing that's very powerful is pre-registration. So I guess a practice that you can enforce in your company would be just to say, like, before we run an analysis, tell us what you think is going to happen. So like this is a thing that, and you know, we were talking earlier about Everything is Obvious by Duncan Watts, and like I think that's like required reading for anyone who's trying to apply like the tools of quantitative social science to their business, because like we're just very good at inventing post hoc narratives for our data, and unless you pre-register your hypotheses, you're going to continue. You're never going to realize how wrong you are. So like the number of times, and actually, you know, this bladder work that I showed, we're submitting that to PLOS Medicine, and they asked us for our pre-registration. Like, what, like they wanted a document showing, like, before this trial happened, what did you say you thought you'd see? And I thought that was very cool, and we actually had that. So that was useful. So I think that is actually a specific piece of advice I could give, is if you're in an environment where people think they know more than they actually know, ask them before you run an analysis or run an experiment, just say, what do you think we're going to learn from this? And let's write that down. And then we can see afterwards if we were right.
We have time for, I think, one more question. I'll go ahead and ask a question. So you mentioned earlier, right in the beginning of the talk, that your work is based on clinical trials data, but that 4% of people with cancer actually participate in clinical trials. So what would, and how does that impact what you, your work, and what would an increase in participation mean for your work? And like what order of magnitude of accuracy, for example, could you get if, you know, more people were enrolled in clinical trials? And then the other sort of related question is, I love the idea that cancer is, you said it's not a disease, it's a process, right? And there are other people in the cancer field who also think about cancer as a disease of like life, right? As a lifestyle disease, that there are, the cure for cancer is actually really good healthcare and having money, right? So what about other variables that impact people's physiological responses that may or may not be in your data set? How do you deal with those kinds of variables?
Yeah, so our work, the tools and techniques you use to pick apart what happened to a handful of people in a clinical trial are very different than the tools and techniques you use to understand what happened to people within a cohort of like a million patients. So if many more people were to be enrolled in cancer clinical trials, then that might become less true. And you know, phase three clinical trials can have thousands of participants. And in fact, Grail is a company that spun out of Illumina recently and is claiming they're gonna try and run they've raised like over $1 billion, I wanna say, or they've registered that they would like to raise over $1 billion. I'm sure they'll get it done. But they're going to be running because they're trying to do cancer diagnosis. So their ability to like determine whether they've done a good job of detecting cancer is a pretty high bar to clear. If you want to give something to a healthy person, that's a lot. You have the burden of proof is a lot higher than if you want to change the drug given to a person known to be sick. There are people who are going to be pushing more cancer patients and healthy people through clinical trials specific for cancer. But in terms of how our job would change, I think the number one thing would be that we would now have a collection of tools that are very well understood. So people like 23andMe that have incredibly large cohorts and are trying to find associations between germline mutations, as discussed earlier, and features of the individual. They have very powerful statistical tools that are just underpowered on our data. And if we had a bigger clinical trial data set, we could bring to bear some of their tools, and that would allow us to more sensitively detect biomarkers. So that's one value. And then in terms of like how do we account for like features of the patient that maybe aren't showing up in like sequencing data or in their electronic medical record. And to be frank, we don't have that information. We actually don't want that information from a privacy standpoint. That's more of a public health perspective than it is sort of a clinical trials perspective. But there, I do think that, you know, for example, the rate of asthma in East Harlem is much higher than you would expect based just on the genetics of the population. So there's something about the physical location and that was actually one of the things that drew me to Mount Sinai as a place to do research, is that the care population is very diverse and exhibits some of these outcomes that diverge from what we would expect due to likely some of the socioeconomic features of the population. That being said, unfortunately, that's just not an area that I do work in. You know, I have 11 people, and we can only solve so many problems. And I ended up kind of getting seduced by the durable remissions of checkpoint blockade, and really wanted to solve this problem. But you know, there's a wonderful peer of mine at Mount Sinai, Prabhjot Singh, who does a lot of very cool work in understanding like public health and asking public health questions about the Mount Sinai community. So I'd be happy to connect you to people that have allocated work budget for those problems, because they are very interesting.
Great, thank you. So everyone, let's again thank Jeff for taking the time to talk with us.